All right, so joining us in the studio is a security expert, Ahmed Kadiri. Many thanks for joining us on TVC Breakfast this morning.
All right, let's start it this way generally. The argument about the issue of herdsmen attacking people, we have heard from different quarters, especially from the Miyeti, those who are in charge of the Fulani grazing, that this attacks are not coming from Fulani people. They could be herdsmen, but they're not Fulani people. We've heard that argument generally. But there hasn't been any effort. We've not been able to place a face or name to these people generally. Arrests have not really been made and all of that. What do you make of all of this?
Well, first of all, I see this as the government not actually making things clear to the likes of you and I. The government not actually coming to the fore to let us know what is being done with regards to this continuous conflict between so-called Fulani herdsmen and landowners and the public in general and with communities as it's currently being done right now. So we need the government to come to the fore to let us know what they are doing, what are the intelligence bodies doing, what are law enforcement bodies doing, to really give us a clear picture as to what is really going on. That's what we need to know right
now.
By
government, who, which of the agencies precisely are you talking about? Can we narrow it down?
Now, when I say government, I'm referring to the likes of intelligence bodies, the SSS. What is the SSS doing to let us know what the underlying factor is in this problem? Are these actually Fulani herdsmen? And if they are, what is being done to address the problem? How do we resolve these issues? We need to know this, and we also need the police to also come into the fore to ensure whenever these problems come up, how has the police been able to address the problem of law and order? So the SSS and the police have to work in sync. They have to work together. The SSS has to provide the intelligence. The police has to come in and ensure that law and enforcement is enforced.
Okay. Now, we'll come back to this, certainly. Now, let's take a look at the states that have been attacked by Fulani herdsmen. We have Benue State, Niger, Taraba, Plateau, Nasarawa, Ekiti, Zamfara, Adamawa, Ondo, and Enugu State.
Of these states, the worst hit are Benue, Niger, Taraba, and Plateau State. If we narrow it down now, Benue State is the worst hit as Fulani herdsmen have repeatedly unleashed terror on different communities there. Scores have been killed, thousands displaced, and their properties worth millions of naira lost. Over the weekend, more than 80 people were killed in Logo and Ukem LGAs of the state. Did I pronounce the name correctly?
Logo, local
Logo
government, and
okay.
Ukum, local government.
Yes,
Now, in February, 10 Agatu communities were razed by herdsmen and scores massacred, an attack which many now refer to as the Agatu bloodbath. Now, more than 300 persons were killed in that attack. Now, Niger State was also attacked recently by Fulani herdsmen. Now, according to reports, herdsmen numbering about 300 attacked Beji Town in the Boso local government area of the state. They killed 4 persons and injured several others. Now, the herdsmen also burned 15 houses, 4 cars, and 17 motorcycles. Another attack, which happened during the Eid al-Fitr celebration, left more than 10 persons dead in Bagi community in Niger State.
The killer herdsmen have also attacked Taraba State a couple of times, causing residents of Angai and Ndolo villages in Gashak local government area to flee after a deadly attack left more than 40 persons dead in their communities. Other communities in Taraba State have been attacked, Gishiri, Hassan, Meshuma, Adore, to mention but a few.
Now, in Plateau State, herdsmen attacked Zim community in Rope district of Barkin Ladi local government area of the state. And also in 2015, more than 20 persons were killed and properties destroyed in Zakupiang community. Forum District by Fulani Herdsmen. Now, Iyom and Barakin Ladi local government areas are the worst hit. And the affected villages in these local governments are Forum, Fan and Biram communities. But how did these herdsmen that once roamed freely and peacefully become dreaded killers? That's the big question. Well, Ahmed Kadiri, let's come back to this issue now. The last question there, the last statement there, it's really very sacrosanct. It's something we need to understand. Growing up, we used to know that Fulani herdsmen roamed the villages, whether, in fact, into, I remember in Edo State, in Benue, anywhere, they were free. In fact, the villagers are happy sometimes when the Fulani, because they know they'll be coming with Nunu, they'll be coming with Fura, and, you know, and so on. I respect them. And when they come, in fact, sometimes I've seen villagers sometimes cook for them because of the friendship that exists and so on. At what point does all of this change?
Good. Now, we can look at that at two fronts. Urbanization, infrastructural development. For instance, in Niger State, where we now have a commercial airport, it used to be a grazing field. Now we have a commercial airport there. And in the same vein, in other parts of the country, urbanization, infrastructural development have evolved. So narrowing down grazing fields, now that leaves limited space for people to farm, and this limited space is jealously guarded. Along comes a Fulani herdsman.
Yeah, so whose problem is that? Because you have population explosion in Nigeria. Whose fault is that?
The government. Lack of planning. We ought to have grazing fields. We ought to now look at individuals to provide ranches for these cattle to graze. The cattle have to feed. You can't deny that. So the government has to plan. With rising urbanization and infrastructural development, the government ought to plan and say, okay, this is the next plan. It's only natural for people to become hostile. When you have cattle coming into your land, it's only natural. Hostilities will evolve. People will clash. And in order to eliminate this totally, the government has to come up with a comprehensive plan. Let's have commercial grazing fields.
All right, beyond the government, now let's look at the private sector or the owners of the cows themselves. If government fails to plan, why can't they plan?
Well, governance still has to come into place. That is the role of governance, supervision. In my mind, I believe in minimal governance, but it has to be in that corner, providing a supervisory role. Now, you approach the owners of this cattle and say, look, why don't you purchase land for your cattle? And where you cannot purchase land, why don't you patronize individuals who are able to provide you with this land?
People who sell fish, for instance, sorry for interrupting you, I'm not sure they have to, you need a poultry, you get the farm, you start rearing your chicks there, and they grow and you supervise and you get, so why can't they do the same?
It's a very expensive venture to feed cattle. I know this from personal experience. It's very expensive. They feed every day. They feed round the clock. So it's an endless supply chain of food. So for you to own cattle, you have to be quite financially buoyant.
It's quite expensive, but it's also very lucrative.
It is very lucrative.
Fine.
It is very lucrative. I agree with you.
So it does pay its own bills.
It pays its own bills. Yeah. So we can look at it at two fronts. If you own a cattle ranch. Where you cannot own a cattle ranch, hire one. I believe this would adequately address the problem.
All right, that's what we expect. Now, on the other hand, if we have to take it back to the issue of the attacks, some of these attacks, the nature of the attacks, don't happen when they are encroaching on lands. It seems like they wait, attack a village when they least expect, sometimes even in the night, and then burn houses, burn cars, and the nature of the attacks seem to be something
that
goes well-planned, coordinated, sophisticated, as the case may be, intelligent sometimes, and then it goes beyond the issue of quarrels between using your land, you not allowing me. It goes to the level at which there's some hate involved.
Well, what we just spoke about recently is just an ideal situation when we talk about just basic Fulani herdsmen. I mean, clash, you stepped on my corn farm and all that. Now, on this level, it now becomes suspicious. Where you find Fulani herdsmen carrying Kalashnikovs and well-planned attacks, ravishing, destroying villages, destroying lives, destroying property, over perhaps no previous clash between the communities and these people, it now brings cause for suspicion. The questions now have to be asked by authorities. Who are these people? Are they actually Fulani herdsmen? Are they terrorists masquerading as Fulani herdsmen?
Some have actually said there's some kind of guest we had a couple of weeks ago said there's this conspiracy theory going on. That means that the policemen, they know who these perpetrators of evil are, but probably won't arrest them or afraid to arrest them. Do you buy the idea?
I would not want to believe that, because that it's a scary imagination to dwell on. Why would the police not come to the fore and let us know who these people are?
Because there have been cases take the Enugu attack, for instance, where there was a wind of such attacks coming. There was an intelligence gathering that there was going to be an attack. So if an intelligence came that there was going to be an attack, I assume in my own little mind that there must be, you must know who and who, those who are involved, perhaps.
And strategies to curtail them.
Well, that's where the government has to really be serious about addressing this problem before it escalates into a threat to national security. I see this as a threat to national security if we do not solve this problem, even if it's just an ordinary Fulani herdsmen versus community problem. If we do not address this problem, it will escalate into something bigger than you and I can handle. Now, if they are just ordinary Fulani herdsmen, I believe there are ways of addressing this problem, the solutions we have discussed earlier. Now, if these are terrorists, the SSS should let us know and let us take the problem from there. The silence on the part of government, to me, is very worrisome. We should do something about this.
All right. We have often heard those who are relevant leaders to all of this said that these people are not Fulani herdsmen. Let us assume that maybe, or how likely, let me put it this way, how likely is it that maybe the remnants, residue from the Boko Haram terrorists, are the ones going into the hinterlands and perpetrating these activities? So the concept of blaming it on Fulani herdsmen is a decoy to change tactics, as the case may be. How likely is that?
Very, very possible. The possibility exists, given the fact that these plans are very well coordinated and they come and go and vanish into the night. I do not think a basic Fulani herdsman has that ability to plan an attack and succeed and go away, and they just vanish into thin air. So the SSS has a lot of work to do. They have to provide the intelligence, they have to dig deep and come out with relevant responses for the public to hear, so that we know what we are actually dealing with. If these are terrorists, they should be crushed. It should be dealt with.
So what do you make of cases where, I'll take you back to the same Enugu attack, where even the chief, so to say, in that particular area, that's the Fulani chief, to that, acknowledge the fact that this attack happened. And the public hearing that we've heard, the Mieti Allah people who can, you remember, who said that if they were provoked, they would retaliate. Doesn't that say a lot about it?
It does. It does, because such a response shows that the hostilities are quite alive. And these hostilities have to be addressed. And these hostilities will continue as long as land is small, as long as there's no space, as long as farmers feel that their territories are being encroached upon. These hostilities will continue.
All right, let's take it beyond there to the tactical aspect of things now. If steps have to be taken by the police or security agencies, like you have put it on their doorstep or on their table, what should be the direct or the likely steps they should take to handle or curtail this situation or this menace?
Good. Now, if these are basic Fulani herdsmen, and the problem is a scarcity of land due to urbanization and development of infrastructure. Now, the authorities have to bring all concerned together to find out ways to address this problem with regard to providing commercial ranches, or those who own their cattle should buy their own land and graze their cattle there. They have to prefer solutions, bring people together to talk. Until that is done, if these are just ordinary Fulani herdsmen, we'll continue to have this problem. And it could escalate and snowball into ethnic conflicts.
We are talking about this now because the one that just happened in Benue, if there is a lull now, you probably won't hear anything about it again until another attack
happens again.
Then you have a knee-jerk reaction.
Because that shouldn't be the case. The authorities should make a vow to themselves and say, okay, this is the last time this is going to happen, and swing into action.
The president actually made a call, according to the spokesman, that those behind all this should be crushed. Another command to be crushed, and they are not being crushed. Do you think the Minister of Defense has fared well as far as this is concerned?
I don't think anybody in authority has fared well as far as this is concerned. If this is happening again, for God's sake, we're talking about 81 lives taken. One life means a lot, not to talk of 81. So the authorities have not fared well. They have bungled all the way. Because if this problem had been resolved 5 years ago, we will not be in this situation we're in. It's reoccurring, and it's getting worse. And the perpetrators, so to speak, are getting more emboldened. So as long as they know that...
Because no arrest has been
no
made.
No arrest has been made. No law enforcement has been done. So they feel, well, we can always do it again. Years ago, we will not be in this situation we're in. It's reoccurring, and it's getting worse. And the perpetrators, so to speak, are getting more emboldened. So as long as they know that...
Because no arrest has been
no
made.
No arrest has been made. No law enforcement has been done. So they feel, well, we can always do it again. It's human nature.
All right. Now, how likely, because we know that we've heard comments from... Because when our reporters went into some of these villages, especially I remember when some of our reporters went to Agatu, when that very bad one happened some time ago, comments from villagers sometimes say, we are ready to defend ourselves, and that is dangerous. The moment the community people say, we are ready and we're going to do everything to defend ourselves, if we get to that level, what kind of scenario will play out when all communities want to start arming themselves to defend themselves against this people?
Chaos and mayhem. Breakdown of law and order. That's the picture we're going to get. And it's only natural for these people to make such statements. Where I can use my village, for example, in Edo State. Fulani herdsmen ravaged my village. And people will get up and say, no, we're not going to let this happen again. We're going to defend our families. We're going to defend our land. Because law enforcement has failed in its job. So the people have to do whatever necessary it is to defend what they have, their loved ones, their properties. It's only normal human reaction in the absence of responsible governance.
All right, Ahmed Kadiri, thank you very much for joining us in TVC Breakfast.
Thank you.